Hello. Thank you all for coming. Today I will talk about nicks and how to start your project and deploy it on let's say modern infrastructure. But first we will start with some basic facts, I would say. So nicks is basically two things. It is a package manager and programming language. So usually we are all used to classic package managers where we write how do we package our software, or we write some kind of recipe. How do we want, what dependency we want to have in our package, what are the package dependencies needed to our software to work. So difference in nicks is that you declare with some programming language, you express yourself in some programming language how your dependency should look like and what your software needs to have to make it run on your machine. So the main thing is that it is so the main difference between classic Debian packaging and the Nix packaging is that you have a full language here, which is inspired by Haskell. So you have some kind of purity. Which means that you can expect from this language that will take care of your dependency like you have in high order languages like Haskell. So there is so you cannot reassign a value. So you cannot, when you define some value, you cannot reassign it. Let's say. So the main point in Nix is that you declare stuff. So you put in this declaration what you describe basically what dependencies or what software do your package needs or your app needs, rather than you write in, I would say, some recipe how to build your package. You write the commands. So basically, you are trying to define, not to write the steps. So we will see. I think the best way to see this, I recorded myself how I type. So okay. I think the best way to see. Just to show you the practical use of this package manager. So first we are running the standard distribution. So we don't have to have anything special to install Nix. So first we will create a Nix directory. So you can see that this all software will be installed in this Nix directory, which is owned by our user. Our user is accidentally a Nix user. So all software will be put here. And we can call this, we can download this package manager with this simple command, and it will install everything in this newly created directory. So what just happened? We got the latest version of the Nix package manager, which is installed, which created the Nix store and installed himself into it. So we have vanilla Ubuntu installation, which is not touched in any way by this externally installed Nix package manager. And next, we will source this package manager dependencies. So we will have in our path, we will get all the Nix commands. So basically, we will have this user now can use this Nix package manager to do anything it provides. So first, we will update our channel. So channels are, let's say, in Ubuntu or Debian way, channels are stable, unstable, testing channels. In Nix, when you download default installation, you get the unstable channel, which is bleeding edge, rolling distribution channel. And now we can start using this without any problem. So first we will try to let's try some software without any installation, let's say. So this will be we will start the Nix shell. So Nix shell is will give us a temporary environment where all our dependency will be available, but only this shell. So let's say we need Python 3.5 for our app to work, and we will start the shell, which will download everything from the binary caches. So we can see that Nix package manager is a source-based distribution. So when we executed, give us the Python 3.5, it calculated all the dependency hashes needed to Python to work. So in this example, all the dependency will be found in binary caches, and we will just download everything and run the Python. So yeah, you can see. So yeah, you can see now that our default Python version is 3.5, not 2 anymore. We can now try. Let's say you want to do some C++ programming or C program, we can use new C-lang. We can easily try any combination. So you can put any combination of software versions you want. You will get temporary environment, and when you leave that environment, your environment will be clean from these dependencies. So you will be back to standard Ubuntu shell. Okay. So basically, when you execute when you manipulate packages in Nix, you are basically just changing your environment. So all the packages are just combinations of symlinks. So we'll see that shortly, how those symlinks work. So yeah, we will get a new symlink here. When we exit, it is not. Oh, we can try Node.js. So if you see from where this Node.js is run, it is located somewhere in Nix store. And Nix store is basically just full of these hashes and program names. And we are just doing composition. Okay? But if you want to install something, or basically put it in our standard environment, we can also do that. And now we have in our local user access to node binary. So we can see that those symlinks are handled in this special directory, which is created by us. And it is also added automatically to our path. So if you go in this binary directory, you will see that those are just symlinks to Nix store binaries. Okay? And yes, uninstalling something from the Nix store is not removing something from the Nix store. We will just remove the symlinks. So basically, this command removed those Node.js and npm modules and left the only the Nix commands here. Okay? So, cool thing about this is that we can also get all the build dependency we need to build some package. Let's say you want to contribute something to the Firefox, and you are lazy because you need to set up all your build environment and, I don't know, read that. We saw on lecture before how hard it can be to install something and all the dependencies. We can, with Nix, it's pretty easy. So this command will find all the dependencies needed for Firefox, not runtime, but build and runtime, and put it in our Nix shell. So environment which we will get after this, we'll be able to compile the full Firefox with all of its dependencies. So which is very cool. So you can easily hack anything you want by just running few commands. So yeah, we can see, if we see our pet, it is crazy full of these Nix store pods. And yes, like I said, we are just composing our software. So we are not installing anything. We just get the environment in which we can access our, I don't know, libraries, binaries, Python pods, anything we are using. Okay, so what are the package definitions? So how do we define some package? So we'll start with simple one, simple Python application. So we would like to run the NumPy and just try it. We don't want to install it on our system. And let's see what will happen. So we'll just run the Nix shell on this declaration, Nix expression, and it will give us a NumPy. Okay. But we would like to run the newer version of the Python. So to do this, we will just edit this declaration, and we will put the new version in. Let's say in the major version. We'll change the major version. Okay? And what will happen now? And now we will see that this is definitely source-based distribution. What happened? So we changed the Python version, and there are no binary caches for the NumPy. So our machine will fetch all the needed dependencies which are needed to build the NumPy from scratch and build it locally. So it usually when you hack something on the unstable channel, you can easily hit the packages which are still in which are not built yet, or they are, I don't know, they have a build which are failing. So Nix will automatically try to compile this for you locally. Okay? Oh yeah, so yeah, this will succeed. You can count on it. So yeah, it will run all the tests. So yeah, we'll get the NumPy built for Python 3.5. Okay. But we would like to also do some Django. And we need Django 2.0. And we'll also put Nginx. It is nice to have load balancer. Why not? So, okay, so Django also needs to be built. I don't know why. This version is not popular on Nix Store. Okay. So it works. But let's try to do something interesting. Let's say you want to override. So you basically, when you compose or when you build software, you always have some exceptions. So you want to override something. So you want to put some other dependencies. So with Nix, it's very easy to change the dependency of the packages, to change the versions you are using. So in this example, we will replace OpenSSL with LibreSSL, because we can. I don't know if it's better, but it's very easy to do in this ecosystem. So this Nginx expression is built that it's very easy to override dependencies, and we will see what will happen. So, of course, there is no cache for this version or this type of Nginx build, because each of these hash is calculation of all the dependencies which are also needed to build this package. So this won't be found on the store, and we will get Nginx locally built, like we did for the NumPy. So yeah, this will take some time. Okay, and yes, we have Nginx built with LibreSSL. Okay, if we don't want this version, we can easily change our declaration, and voila, it won't build anything. We already have this locally downloaded, and we can easily switch back to OpenSSL version. Why not? Okay? So, also, good advantage from Nix is that you can easily make your app or your package reproducible. So in Nix, we do it in a way that you just pin the upstream packages to some Git commit. So all the packages which we are using are located in Nix packages repository. And we will just use the GitHub's mechanism to get the tarball, okay, from some Git commit. And when we do this, we won't use Nix packages which are constantly updated on our system. We will use some version which is pinned. In this case, yeah, something from tomorrow, from yesterday. So, okay. And the last example is we can use Nixshell directly from our script. So we can just change our shebang to Nixshell and put the any packages we want. So we'll put NumPy, and that's basically it. We just run our app and it works. Because everything is composition of the packages which are needed by some declaration, we can easily clean our environment. So you can see that we are downloading like crazy here for anything we want. So Nix can easily clean our repository from all the unneeded declarations or binary caches. So with this command, we'll just delete everything, because there is no reference to any of these packages on our current system. So that's basically it from this live part. So let's just recap. So the most important idea from this Nix package is, in my opinion, is not the way the language is designed or anything like that. Is this idea that you have unique hash of all dependencies which are needed for your package. If from this idea you get all the good parts or unique parts this package manager provides. So this hash is for bash, let's say, is not the hash from the bash source. It's the hash from all the build flags, all the dependency versions which are needed to have to get this version of the bash. Also, if you see the dynamic libraries, which are, let's say, needed for Python, they are all located somewhere in Nix store. So you basically, when you upgrade your Python version, you don't remove anything. You just switch to some other version, which is pointing to something else in the Nix store. Okay? There is no upgrade and downgrade, obviously. So we just use this to compose our software. And I go fastly with this, let's say, derivations from this idea. So obviously there is Nix package manager and repositories of Nix packages. There is also operating system or Linux distribution, which is built on top of Nix package manager. There is also continuous build system, which is very, very, very uniquely designed, and DevOps tools and some distributed deployment tools. Okay, this was our derivation, if you remember, and this is how we pinned the packages. And finally, we have declaration which will generate a Docker image, in this example, for Redis server. So we can declare how our Docker image will look like by writing this derivation. And result will be minimal Docker image, which is 48 years old. Why it's 48 years old? Because Nix resets all the time to epoch time. So to make it to all the builds to be more look-alike. So, and yeah, we have Hydra, which is so cool. Yeah, it's standard continuous integration. But if you see, if you go and see some failure in Hydra, you will see that you can easily reproduce everything. You just need to have Nix installed and curl to get the same build failure you have on remote machine, which is very, very useful. And we use it to debug our software. Okay, that's do we have any time?
One question, what did you use before you switched to Nix? And from the presentation, I guess it is, well, there are some people, open source people, volunteers, who take care of pre-packaging and preparing all the sources. So your Nix knows where to download it from?
Yes.
Is it correct?
Yes, there is a Nix packages repository where you can update or add your software. So you can write your own expressions and put it there. Mm-hmm. So it's pretty rich. So you have all, it is almost like Debian repository, I would say. So it's very easy to write it, and nothing is pre-built there. So you have caches and the source files. And it's very easy to rebuild the whole stack because you are just composing and building up your derivations in a way you like.
And, well, the first question, did you use something else before Nix, or it was just the operating system, I don't know, in Ubuntu Debian packages, or what did you use before you switched over to Nix?
So, I wrote some RPM packages, but mostly I wrote Debian, Debian packaging, and I like very much Debian packaging, but it is lacking this flexibility. So in my opinion, the best distribution is Gentoo. So you build everything from
scratch. I'm a fan of Gentoo.
Yeah, but this is, let's say, evolution of Gentoo. So you finally have something which is, you finally can easily download binary packages. But in other way, you can easily rebuild everything from scratch if you want. So with this system, you can easily port it to any platform. You just let the software build. If something fails, you fix and you go.
Thank you.
Do we have any more questions? If not, I'd like to thank Luka for the final speech of the day.